Now that the summit is starting, what is your perspective on the discussions that are going to take place here?
Well, first I want to say that I had really high expectations about this summit today, this 2 weeks. I'm particularly surprised that at the start, what the issues dominating the news here in Paris are not the issues that should be dominating the news. I mean, we've got approximately 150 different heads of government gathered here, and the idea is that they will be discussing the climate and the problem of climate change, right? But that's not really what's happening. I mean, what we see in the news is talk about terrorism, you know, and even when they give some kind of coverage to the COP, to the meeting itself, to climate change itself, it's from the point of view of protesters on the streets who got tear gas yesterday. It's also from the point of view that Obama will be meeting the Turkish, you know, president, or that this is an opportunity for Turkey to meet with Putin and all that. So we hear a lot of interplay, you know, a lot of conversations dealing with other aspects of global politics. It seems to me that the leaders of delegation, the leaders of nations who are here to discuss climate change, have more serious things which are of greater interest to them to discuss other than climate change. And that worries me a great deal. That gives me the impression that perhaps these talks may not have the kind of desired outcomes, you know, the kind of outcomes which we expect it to have. I think that the issue of climate change needs to be taken with a lot more seriousness than it is currently. If the news reports, which I've seen on CNN and BBC and elsewhere, are anything to go by, I'm very doubtful.
So, maybe you give us an impression, what is your organization's specific agenda in the climate issue?
Social Action, the organization I work for in Nigeria, we are deeply interested in the manner that mitigation mechanisms are being put in place. We are concerned that some of these mechanisms being put in place are actually, they are not solving the problem, but they are instead causing more problems. For instance, in Nigeria, the government of Cross River State has cordoned off an entire area, a very large expanse of forest, and is preserving that, according to it, for RED, for the implementation of RED schemes, right? And we have keenly studied the manner in which the government is trying to do that, and we have discovered that it seriously violates issues, community rights, livelihood rights. We have seen situations where community members are being asked to leave certain areas. People are not allowed to expand their farms. People are not allowed to build houses anymore. People are not allowed to farm, to hunt, to get into the forest, to harvest. You know, so we see that traditional livelihood alternatives for the people, traditional livelihood sources of the people, are being completely eroded because the government is interested in implementing RED in Cross River Forest. And the reality for us is that, I mean, the body language which we get from the state, you know, in the implementation of RED is not because they are interested in preserving the climate. I think that the discussion about RED in Cross River State has been reduced to carbon credits. The need for the government of the state and the federal government to get some kind of money coming from carbon credits, right? So that's the only incentive. And for the people, for the communities in Nigeria, they're actually interested in preserving the forest. They're actually interested in helping suck carbon emissions from the earth. They see themselves as heroes who are going to preserve the planet for generations yet unborn, right? But the perspective of the government is completely different, and we are concerned about the manner community livelihoods and rights are being completely eroded just because RED is being implemented. And that's a source of concern for us.
Thanks. And so what do you think is like Nigeria's official delegation position in these climate talks?
Well, I'm yet to hear the Nigerian president speak. I know that there's a position document which the Nigerian government has got in place. I haven't seen that yet, but I believe that any such document which the Nigerian government has should take into consideration the fact that Nigeria's Niger Delta is the single most intense space of global of carbon emissions in the world at the moment. I mean, we still have gas flaring, routine gas flaring, scattered all around the Niger Delta of Nigeria, you know, and we don't have gas flaring because there is no alternative. The fact is that there are other ways of doing this business, you know, as negative as it is, doing this business, but with cleaner perspective to it. But Nigerian government allows gas flaring to continue even when a federal high court sitting in Benin City in 2005 has declared gas flaring as being illegal. the Nigerian government allows gas flaring continue and instead prescribes paltry fines for oil companies who flare gas. So we have a joint venture partnership with the Nigerian government having the commanding shares of that joint venture partnership. And the Nigerian government accepts gas flaring in its territory, but at the same time pretends to be fighting global warming. You cannot on the one hand say you are fighting global warming, but on the other hand allowing gas flaring to continue without any flare out date in place, without any plan to stop in it. That's impossible. So any position document by the Nigerian government, I expect to see it containing an end to gas flaring. If it doesn't contain that, it's useless to the summit.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Ken.